listening to WMNH 95.3. The commander to the supreme leader, Mezzo coming down.
Welcome, everybody. Here we go. It is that time again. Happy Tuesday. It is Matt Connerton Unleashed, and we are live from the studios of WMNH 95.3 FM in glorious, and it is a glorious day outside, glorious downtown Manchester, New Hampshire. Also on Comcast Channel 6 if you're in Manchester, and hello to all of our online listeners across the nation. And around the globe, you can go to my website, mattconnerton.com, for all of your live streaming options, social media links, contact info, show archives, etc., etc. Tuesday, September 26, 2023, we've got a great show for you today. Coming up in the second hour, we have an amazing in-studio band coming in, or a band coming into the studio. I should put more thought in how I construct my sentences. We have Fox and the Flamingos coming in, and they are going to play live for us, but we also have some studio tracks to feature during that hour as well, including a brand new song that they'll be debuting today. Really looking forward to that. I love this band. I love their sound. Really, really good. So they're going to come in. They will be here during the second hour, Numero Dos, today. One of the band members, Gary Smith, he's been on the show before, kind of recently. He's also in the band Jam Tomorrow with Michael Hauptley Pierce, with whom I used to be in a band with years ago, and another gentleman. So they're a trio. But today, Gary is coming in with Fox and the Flamingos, and such a great sound. Such a great sound. So looking forward to that. I'm doing my best here. If I seem a little bit off, excuse me. It always affects me too. I got my updated COVID vaccine today. Check this out, anti-vaxxers. I got both the updated COVID shot, Moderna, and my flu shot all at the same time. Can you believe it? Can you believe it? That's right. Oh, yeah. I'm not fooling around. But, you know, and I probably chased off the anti-vaxxers a long time ago. I said some insulting things about them. But, I believe in science. I believe in modern medicine. And I believe in using the tools that are at our disposal to stay healthy. I went and did that. Jenny did as well. It worked out well, actually, better than I expected, because I had, in fact, it was Friday night during Retro Spectrum Radio with Pauly C. I was sitting at the news desk. I was online and I was trying to schedule, because I knew that the updated COVID vaccines were about to be available here in New Hampshire. So I was online trying to schedule an appointment, and the pharmacy that I usually go to, that I got my other shots at, the earliest they had, like, you can get a flu shot pretty much any time, but the earliest appointments they had for the COVID vax were like middle of October. I was like, oh. So I shopped around a little bit, and Walgreens in Hooksett, they had an appointment open for Saturday at 12:45 in the afternoon. I said, wonderful. So I grabbed that appointment. And then I got a call first thing Saturday morning, the next morning, from the pharmacist at the Walgreens, who said, hey, really sorry about this, but we actually don't have the new COVID shot yet. And we told corporate we haven't received them yet. But for some reason, the website, the main website, is still letting people make appointments for this vaccine that we don't have yet. He said, I'm expecting it Monday, Tuesday at the latest. So I'll give you a call. If you want, I can put you on the list. And I'll give you a call by the latest you'll hear from me Tuesday morning. And I said, great. Okay. And I think he probably had a list of people to call, because he kind of went out of his way to thank me for being so understanding. So some people he called probably had been yelling at him, But, you know, I'm a pretty understanding person, and, you know, I'm sure it's not his fault. So I just said, yeah, no problem. So, by the way, it is now, at the tone, the time will be, it is now 4:17 p.m., and I still have not heard from Walgreens. So, good job. Anyway, but that's all right. Doesn't matter. I took Jenny this morning to get her flu shot, and she said while she was in there, she would ask if they have the updated COVID vaccine at the pharmacy that we usually go to, and they did. And I was waiting out in the car, and she texted me, and she said, they have it. She said, you should come in, see if you can get vaxxed. So I did. I went in, and I was able to get vaccinated as well for both the COVID and the flu shot. So just so you know, if you are someone who is waiting to do that, if you're in the Manchester area, I don't know if all the Rite Aid locations are like this, but the one that we go to, you don't even need an appointment. You can make an appointment online, but they also take walk-ins, and they were able to get me in right after Jenny, no problem. So if it's something that you want to do, but you're kind of putting it off because you think it's going to be a hassle or whatever, Rite Aid is taking walk-ins, just so you know. So I suggest you get vaccinated. But like I said, I'm one of those crazy people who believes in science and modern medicine. I know it's kind of the cool thing today. You know, the cool kids, they don't believe in that. They think if you believe in that, that you're just doing what Joe Biden tells you to do, or I don't know, whatever the hell it is that they think. or if you get vaxxed, you're going to get myocarditis and your heart's going to explode. Not true. There is, you know, you got to love the conspiracy theorists. There are a very small, tiny percentage of people who do get myocarditis if they get vaccinated, which is obviously anything to do with the heart is potentially frightening. But it goes away. It doesn't last for too long, and it goes away. You do want to see a doctor if you're having any issues, of course. But and I'm not a medical professional. This is just my view of it. This is not medical advice. But the conspiracy theorists, you know, I see them all the time online on social media, and that's one of their go-tos. They're like, oh, it causes myocarditis. See, it's dangerous. And it's like, yeah, in a very tiny sliver of people who've been vaccinated, there has been an issue. By the way, what the conspiracy theorists leave out about that is there's actually something else that can happen that is statistically way more likely to cause myocarditis, exponentially more likely to cause myocarditis. Do you know what that is? I know I have a smart audience, so I probably don't even have to say it, but I'll say it for anyone who doesn't know. Getting COVID. Yes, getting COVID actually is way more likely to cause myocarditis than the vaccine. So if you're thinking about it logically and using common sense, I mean, I know conspiracy theories are fun and it makes you feel like, ooh, I'm not one of the sheeple. I'm an independent thinker. I understand that there's people who feel that way. I think it makes you look foolish personally, but you don't care what I think because, you know, I believe in science. I'm one of those people. So anyway, yes, far more dangerous to get COVID than to get vaccinated, just so you know. And if there are any anti-vaxxers listening, I realize everything that I'm saying falls on deaf ears. And that's okay. And by the way, at this point, I don't really care. Like before, when we were in the full-on pandemic phase, I was very much encouraging people, please get vaccinated, not only for your sake, but for all of us, for all of us. At this point, you know, we're able to protect ourselves, those of us who want to get vaxxed. We're able to protect ourselves by getting vaxxed. If you want to take the chance, on this point, it's on you. So everybody do what you want. But I got vaccinated today and I feel good about it. I'm a little bit fatigued, but that happens every time. And Shannon is on the line. Hi, Shannon.
Hello. Good afternoon.
Yes.
I can't do that same voice with afternoon for some reason.
Okay, your voice changes depending on the time of day.
No, you could do the good morning and good evening, but
I don't do either. I don't do either one, Shannon. How dare you insinuate that?
You should have got. Have you been vaccinated for the shingles?
I have not.
Well, you should have got that too and gone for the trifecta.
Oh, well, if we have a problem with our shingles, we inform our landlord. I'm just kidding. We don't inform our landlord. He might raise the rent. We keep our mouths shut. Jeez.
Oh, I got a question. You
please,
have
please, please chat. Don't, please don't cough directly into the phone, Shannon, if you don't mind.
Sorry, did I?
Yes, I and my eardrums will recover eventually. But yes, you coughed directly into the phone. So just be aware of that going forward. Thank you. Yeah, appreciate it. Thanks. Glad we had this talk. Yes, go ahead, Shannon.
You guys have a couple cats, right?
We have two beautiful cats.
Or I should say you are owned by.
Yes, that is true. We have to clean up after them. That is true, yes. But we don't mind. We love them.
Yeah, any cat owners out there know they are owned by the cat.
That is true. That is true.
Do you have your windows open in the mornings?
Not now. It's cold.
Well, yeah. Comfortable, but like they get the fresh air, the cool fresh air.
Oh, sure. Yeah, absolutely.
Huh?
Yeah. Well, when it's warm enough, when the windows are open, yeah.
Well, my window is open always in the kitchen, and my cat today, Turbo Pussy.
Okay. Well, I don't know what saying, but yeah, let's not even take the chance. I don't even say the name of that band. Yes. All right.
Was that a band?
Not exactly, but close. That should be. Yeah. All right, Shannon. Let's call them cats or felines going forward, just so there's no misunderstandings. I've been here 6.5 years, and I'm not looking to get fired just yet.
Well, I'm talking about a cat.
I understand, but I just so there's no misunderstandings. You know what I'm saying?
With corporate.
Yes, with corporate.
Yeah, corporate.
A lot of people don't know this, but WMNH is actually owned by a much larger company called Super Global Opti Megacorp, and they are very, very strict.
Yeah, and that could have been a bunch of BS for all I know.
Nope, that's the name of the company. How dare you? Look it up. Super Global Opti Megacorp. You think I just memorized that for my health? That's the name of the company.
No, you could have just, maybe. Well, no, because you still can't get Channel 6 all the time. You still say 97 once in a while. So, I don't know.
Unless
you read it somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Yeah, I read it on a company memo. Says it right there in giant letterhead. Super Global Opti Megacorp.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All righty. Well, hi, DJ Steve, if you're in there.
Oh, got your eyes on him
now. There.
Yeah. All right. Well, all right, Shannon. Thank you for the call.
Bye.
All right. Bye-bye. All right. That was our friend Shannon. That does open up the line for you, 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007, if you would like to join us. And don't put it off if you're thinking about calling, because we do have a great musical guest coming up in the second hour, Numero Dos. We've got some, in fact, I should just mention, too, just briefly, because we've got not only a musical guest today, but tomorrow and Thursday as well. Let's see. Tomorrow we have Hands of Spite, which is a great name for a band. And then on Thursday we have After the Winter. So we've got some good stuff coming up on the program. But again, 603-250-6007 is the number. If you would like to join us today, we should take a moment and say hello to everybody in the Facebook live chat. Eric Pilcher, of course, joins us in the chat room. Eric is, he does our classic film reviews. We ran his newest review yesterday for the film Martin, directed by George A. Romero. Eric has been honoring the films of George A. Romero during the month of September. Carol Zaworowitz, joins us in the chat and says hi. Hello, Carol. Jenny is in there, of course, and says, shalom, peeps. EZG Eric Gagnon says, happy Tacos Tuesday. I thought it was Taco Tuesday. Eric wrote it as plural, Tacos Tuesday. Now, Eric, gluttony is a sin. Let's try to keep it to one taco, please. I mean, if you're still hungry, maybe after you can have a burrito, but let's not be greedy. Wonder Suede joins us in the Facebook live chat and says, hi, hashtag Jen Coffee. From us to you, and good afternoon. Jay Fed from the great state of Vermont says, good afternoon, everyone. Wonder Suede says, good. I knew it was going here. Wonder Suede says, good afternoon, hashtag Jason Fetterson, from us. We are a pop singing group, Wonder Suede, and we did not hack Isaac Banks. We are okay and fine. We say keep on doing your impressions from us. Be a good comedian from us to you, Jason Fetterson. Well, you can't just tell Jason Fetterson to do impressions on command. He's not a dancing bear. I mean, my goodness, he's a human being. Please. Jenny's saying, do you glow in the dark now? That's regarding my getting vaccinated. I don't know. It's still daylight. It's very bright. Couldn't tell you. JFed says, wow, and now you don't feel well. Imagine that. Yes, that's the thing. That's my, so the flu shot, I never have a reaction to, but the COVID shot, yes, it always makes me, just for that day, I get fatigued. And then by the next day, I'm fine. Some people have more severe side effects. But again, it's better than getting COVID. Just saying, just putting that out there. I don't believe it's Bill Gates and George Soros colluding to microchip me or anything like that, or whatever the newest conspiracy theories are. Let's see. Wonder Suede says, Jen Coffee from us. How are you doing? And Jenny said, good and you. And Wonder Suede says, Jen Coffee doing fine from us. We definitely will be performing soon for karaoke at Center City Park downtown Greensboro, North Carolina. Well, of course. Of course. And Wonder Suede says, hashtag Matt Connerton from us. That's extraordinary for you that you got a vaccine shot from us. Well, I didn't get it from you, Wonder Suede. I got it from Rite Aid. JFed says, sounds like you care regarding my my rant about how, no, if you don't want to get vaccinated, do what you want. I don't care. I really don't care at this point. I mean, we're in a position where, you know, those of us who want to protect ourselves and those around us, we can, and we can exercise that option. And if you want to take the risk of getting sick and, you know, hospitalizations are up across the country and so forth, But that's on you. I mean, there is an element of Darwin to it, right? Like if you want to, believe, in some nonsense and, take the risk, then go ahead, believe in your nonsense and take the risk. But, pandemics are real. It's not a global conspiracy. It's a real thing that happens about every 100 years. And, you have to be, well, you don't have to be, apparently, but you should be an adult and, deal with it and confront it. And, you know, we all get through it, right? That's my view of it. I'm ranting like it's 2 years ago or 3 years ago or however long. Oh, my God. No, I think we're, again, at this point, you know, I think we're stuck with it for the rest of our lives with COVID. But I think it's going to be, well, I think it already is at this point. It's just, you know, going forward, it's just going to be an annual thing. You know, you get a flu shot, those of you who choose to do that. I know many don't, but, it'll be, you know, it's an option. You get a flu shot, you get a COVID shot. And then you go about your business. And then the next year you'll have to do it again. You know, it just becomes an annual thing. And eventually they might be able to combine the two into one formulation. I don't know. Who knows? But, you know, and with the medications that we have now, I mean, Paxlovid apparently works wonders. If you do have COVID and you have severe symptoms, if you use Paxlovid, which is more and more available. And, you know, there's a lot. I did hear one epidemiologist say that at this point, no one really should be dying. At least no one who's vaccinated certainly should be dying of COVID. You should be, you should be able to use the therapeutics and not even end up in the hospital, ideally. But, you know, but there are a lot of people who are, you know, hospitalizations are up. It's getting to be that time of year and things are spreading and, you know. But again, at least we're at a point where it's like, I feel like, okay, you know, we can take care of ourselves by doing the things that we know are smart. Not that things that we think are smart, but things that we know are smart. Again, no offense to, you know, those who see it differently, but to me, it's not an opinion. It's a fact. And, you know, and we can continue to move forward. That's how I see it. All right. 603-250-6007 is the studio line if you'd like to join us. 603-250-6007. Something that I wanted to look at further. We didn't get a chance to get into it yesterday. By the way, if you missed yesterday's show, we had Kyle Heavey from Off the Mark Sports was here with us for the full 2 hours. which was really cool. And of course, we had Eric Pilcher's classic film review as well yesterday, as I mentioned earlier. But so we didn't get to, but we didn't get to any of this. Bob Menendez, we talked about him at the end of last week, senator from the state of New Jersey. He's in a lot of trouble, if you don't know. And yeah, I've had, I've been thinking about this a lot, actually. I've had Menendez on my mind, I guess you could say. That's a song, isn't it, actually? Little River Band does that, right? Was it, Baby Menendez on my mind? He's got a weight on his shoulders. You know, this time he might end up in prison. I don't know. Anyway, Little River Band. All right. Something interesting. Now, what has happened, even while there's continuing breaking news, this is kind of a rolling story because, Ed Murphy joins us in the chat. I wanted to say hi to Ed because we don't see him in there very often lately. Ed says, between Shannon's phone call and Wondersuede comments, I'm dazed and confused. It's okay, Ed. That's all right. Just go with it. That's what I do. So today, Senator Cory Booker, the junior senator from the great state of New Jersey, is now calling on Senator Bob Menendez to resign over these allegations, these charges. I think that, you know someone's in real trouble when their own party is saying that they should resign and is not being coy about it, not being shy about it, certainly. You know, typically, and I've talked about this a lot on the show over the years, is when people talk about accountability, they tend to talk about it or think about it in partisan terms, right? You know, Democrats typically want to hold Republicans accountable, and Republicans typically want to hold Democrats accountable. But there's usually a lot of whataboutism that comes into play when people don't want to hold their own side accountable. But there are exceptions, and this is one. And this is how you know somebody's really in serious trouble. When people on their own ideological side or their own party are wanting them to go away. Now, there might be other factors. It might not be as simple as someone saying, wow, this looks really, really bad. So even though this person is the same party as me, I'm going to demand that they resign. There are other factors, and time permitting, we might talk about that a little bit. But the drumbeat is getting louder. But I learned a couple of interesting things over the weekend. I learned this. So Menendez, and if you missed it yesterday, Menendez gave a speech addressing it, although he left a lot of things out in terms of what he addressed. Some of the details in the theory of the case, as it were. I don't think he, what was it that he left out? There was a major thing that he left out specifically. Well, I don't think he addressed, for example, why he destroyed all those text messages and emails, which, you know, probably any police department in America with any forensic skills whatsoever can recover all of that stuff. But people still delete things and think that they're gone forever, which obviously shows a consciousness of guilt, right? If you've had any sort of communications that you're actively trying to hide, then, you know, there must be a reason why you're trying to hide them. Anyway, he gave his statement, and he said that he is not resigning, and apparently he intends to run for real. He's up for re-election in 2024, which is going to pose some interesting questions and challenges for the Democrats. So they're calling on him to just resign. They want him to just go away. New Jersey is a very blue state, so, you know, he would ultimately, I mean, the governor there, is it Phil Murphy? The governor there would appoint somebody in the interim, but then they would have not a special election. They would have the election on schedule when Menendez's term is up anyway, regardless of who replaces him in the interim, and then they would elect another Democrat. It's, again, New Jersey is a very blue state. But somebody pointed out, a legal analyst, and I missed who it was. Sometimes I listen to Dan Abrams. I really like his show, but it wasn't him. But I think it was somebody he was talking to pointed out the era of politicians resigning from their current positions in government is seems to be over. People don't resign anymore. They try to ride it out when they get indicted for something when they're currently sitting in office, and there's other examples. But the reason for this is, and this had never occurred to me before, but someone pointed it out and it made perfect sense. The reason they stay and the reason why Menendez, even though this all looks very, very bad, very damning. Again, everyone's entitled to the presumption of innocence, but this looks really bad. The reason they stay in office, even when the pressure is on and when they're really feeling the heat, is because if they resign, they've given away something that they could have used later when dealing with the prosecution. So, for example, let's say there's a possibility of a plea agreement. Well, in this case, speaking of Senator Bob Menendez, if there is an opportunity for a plea agreement, he might be able to use his seat as a United States senator as something he'd be willing to give up. Well, okay, in this plea agreement, I'm willing to give up being a United States senator in exchange for not going to prison, right? So if you actually resign, no matter how much trouble you're in, if you resign, you're giving something up that you might wish you had still had later on when you're trying to make a plea agreement. The other interesting thing that happened over the weekend was that Menendez really kind of stepped in it when he attempted, he tried to play the race card, I guess would be the best way of putting it. He insinuated that the only reason, and by the way, he didn't say this in his presentation yesterday, but he did say this over the weekend. He tried to insinuate that the only reason he's getting picked on is because he's Cuban American, and because he's Latino, it's an opportunity to try to push a Latino out of his Senate seat. That blew up in his face pretty quickly because one of the people over the weekend. Now, as far as senators, who was the first? John Fetterman, senator from Pennsylvania, was the first one over the weekend to call for his resignation. But there had been several. Now there's several, including Cory Booker. But over the weekend, it was Fetterman and several Democratic House members. One of those Democratic House members happened to be Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, or often referred to as AOC. She called for his resignation. So, so that whole, you know, they're just after me because I'm Hispanic, they're just being racist, that blew up in his face pretty quickly because she was one of the ones calling for him to resign. So that didn't go well for him. So he did not repeat that assertion during his presentation yesterday. But the heat continues to rise on this guy. But here's the other problem. Now, this is not a problem so much for him as for the Democrats. I mean, if he were to go now, fine. Like I said, Governor Phil Murphy will appoint another Democrat to fill that seat. And whoever Murphy appoints will probably run for the seat for 2024 and probably win. Again, New Jersey is a very blue state. So, you know, it's not like there could be a Republican hopeful candidate waiting in the wings to, you know, for an opportunity to jump in. But it's unlikely, it would seem. So the problem, though, is this. If Menendez says not only is he not resigning. Oh, he did step down from his chair from being chair of the is it the Foreign Relations Committee? Senate Foreign Relations Committee. He stepped down his chair, but he's not resigning his Senate seat. If he is running for re-election, well, he's already got all these Democrats saying he should resign. How's that going to go? There may actually be an opportunity for a Republican to sneak in there. If Menendez is going to be on the ballot, while at the same time he's, again, everyone's entitled to the presumption of innocence, but this looks very bad. You know, what happens? Or does New Jersey stick with him? New Jersey did stick with him the first time in 2017, and we talked about it at the end of last week. In 2017, the first time, well, not the first time, but the most recent time before this one, that Menendez was in pretty serious trouble, and was in the midst of scandal. And what's happening now is really, it relates to all of what was happening before. Not only did he get away with, you know, it was a hung jury, but even with all of his problems, and he had ethical issues raised before that, even with all of that was happening, he still won re-election. He won re-election in 2018. Even with all of that, New Jersey was willing to stick by him. Now, there were no Democrats that I can remember at that time who were calling for his resignation like they are now. And then you get into the really interesting part. I mean, this part is really just speculation and conjecture. But there's two things that are different. One is the obvious one, that what he's facing now is far more severe than what he was facing in 2017. This probably isn't going to have a hung jury. I mean, you're talking about cash hidden in the freezer, and you're talking about gold bars, and you're talking about a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff that he did not address in his presentation yesterday. So you've got all that. But the other thing that's different is you have a Democrat as governor. When this was happening in 2017, when Menendez was dealing with all this, you had a Republican, you had Chris Christie as the governor of New Jersey. Now, what's the difference? Why does that matter? Well, that matters because if Menendez had resigned, or if he had been forced to leave because he was convicted, that seat would have opened up. Now, different states have different rules, but I think in most states, the rule is the governor gets to appoint someone to fill that seat. Now, again, they're temporary. They're a placeholder because there will be another election on schedule. And that schedule doesn't change. But if Menendez had gone away in 2017, Chris Christie could have appointed a Republican to that Senate seat. Whereas now, the Democrats don't have to worry about that. So it does beg the question, is that part of the calculus here? You know, over the weekend, John Fetterman, like I said, was the first senator, and then several House members, including AOC. Now it's even Cory Booker, the junior senator from the state of New Jersey, saying, yeah, he should go. But by all indications, he's not going. Because like I said before, strategically, he's better off staying there because it's something to bargain with down the line if he needs something to bargain with. And let's be honest, he probably will need something to bargain with. Chris Poirier, or Poirier, I'm never sure how to say it, but better known as Crispy, comedian, he says, President-elect Joe Biden team could end all this by ending the qualified immunity, increase the Supreme Court and martial law to arrest all corrupt politicians and judges. Now. Garland, Blinken, got to go now. Oh, my goodness. Well, that's... that sounds, I don't think that's on the menu, Crispy, any of that. I'm not even exactly sure I understood all of it, but I will say this, you're thinking outside the box. Ed Murphy points out in the chat room, Menendez does dress better than Fetterman. Well, everyone dresses better than Fetterman, but as we've discussed on the show too, John Fetterman, he's 6'8". I mean, it's gotta be a little challenging to find, clothes that fit. I mean, I can't even imagine. But to your point, I mean, Menendez, he probably dresses better than most senators, actually. I will say this for Bob Menendez. He's got style. He does. He's a snappy dresser. So, if nothing else now, I don't know how he's going to look in orange. No. I'm sorry. Again, the presumption of innocence. Let's be honest. He's probably going to prison. Retro Spectrum Radio with Paulie C is in the Facebook live chat. And says, this Friday night, we have a tribute to Dr. Demento. Friday night at 8 p.m. Eastern. Yes, of course, Retro Spectrum Radio with Paulie C. every Friday night from 8 to 11 p.m. live right here from the studios of WMNH. And I have the honor and privilege of being one of Paul's co-hosts on that show, along with DJ Steve and, of course, whomever sits in with us. We had Dan was with us last Friday. By the way, someone... You know who's defending Menendez? Not a Democrat, but Tom Cotton, a Republican Senator Tom Cotton, This is from thehill.com. This surprised me. It says Senator Tom Cotton, Republican of Arkansas, defended Senator Bob Menendez amid calls to resign from Democratic lawmakers, saying a jury and his voters should determine his fate. Quote, Senator Menendez has a right to test the government's evidence in court, just like any other citizen. He should be ruled by jurors and New Jersey's voters, not by Democratic politicians who now view him as inconvenient to their hold on power, unquote, Cotton said on a post on X, formerly known as Twitter. Menendez was charged last week. This will be a good recap in case you've forgotten. Menendez was charged last week with bribery and was accused of accepting gifts, including cash and gold bars, in exchange for his help through his role as the senior senator from New Jersey and as the now former chairman of the powerful Senate Foreign Relations Committee. He was accused of helping businessmen from his state and those with connections to Egypt's government. Menendez has maintained his innocence and called the federal indictment a result of an active smear campaign against him. Cotton called the charges against Menendez, quote, serious and troubling, unquote, but he also used the opportunity to reject any effort to exonerate the Department of Justice from GOP accusations of so-called corruption and political bias. Ah, that's his angle. Attacks that have only increased since former President Trump was charged in two separate federal indictments. Right, because remember, there's some people who will say that the DOJ and the FBI and everything, it's all run by Democrats now. Cotton also said on Twitter, quote, the charges against Menendez are serious and troubling. At the same time, the Department of Justice has a troubling record of failure and corruption in cases against public figures, from Ted Stevens to Bob McDonnell. I forgot about Bob McDonnell, to Donald Trump, to Bob Menendez, the last time around, unquote. Cotton's statement comes as over a dozen Democratic colleagues in Congress and from his state have called on Menendez to resign. Yeah, the last time I can recall in recent memory, of course, when members of one's own party were very publicly calling for resignation was, of course, when Governor Andrew Cuomo in the great state of New York was in a lot of trouble, sexual harassment accusations against him. And yeah, that got to a point pretty quickly where a lot of Democrats were saying, yeah, you gotta go. But you don't see that often. And he actually did go, but I don't think he he wasn't charged with anything criminally, was he? I can't remember now. But we do know that his brother, Chris, was trying to help him out a little bit. Hey, just something really quickly, too, on another subject, and then I see musicians in the hallway, so we're going to change over and get ready for hour number two pretty quick here. But Mediaite reports Canadian House Speaker resigns for leading Parliament to applaud a Nazi veteran he called a hero. Jenny brought this to my attention yesterday. It says here, Canadian House Speaker Anthony Rota has resigned after leading the Canadian Parliament to applaud a Ukrainian man who fought for the Nazis in World War II. Oops. Rota became the center of a firestorm last week for inviting 92-year-old Ukrainian Waffen-SS veteran. Forgive me, I'm going to butcher this. Why even say the guy's name? He's a Nazi. Who cares? I'm not even going to say his name. To attend a session of parliament hosting Volodymyr Zelensky. It was after a speech from the Ukrainian president that Rada saluted the guy as he sat in the gallery, calling him a hero and prompting applause from Zelensky, Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, and the rest of the assembly. This guy's Nazi past came to light. As his Nazi past came to light, Trudeau called the situation deeply embarrassing for the parliament as Rota apologized while he faced outrage from the Jewish community. Today, Rota once again offered his regrets while announcing his resignation as speaker. And here is his statement. It's with a heavy heart that I rise to inform members of my resignation as Speaker of the House of Commons. It has been my greatest honor as a parliamentarian to have been elected by you, my peers, to serve as the Speaker of the House of Commons for the 43rd and 44th Parliament. I've acted as your humble servant to this House, carrying out the important responsibilities of this position to the very best of my abilities. The work of this House is above any of us. Therefore, I must step down as your Speaker. I reiterate my profound regret for my error in recognizing an individual in the House during the joint address to Parliament of President Zelensky. That public resignation has caused pain. I'm sorry, that public recognition has caused pain to individuals and communities, including the Jewish community in Canada and around the world, in addition to survivors of Nazi atrocities in Poland, among other nations. I accept full responsibility for my actions. My resignation is effective at the end of the sitting day tomorrow, Wednesday, September 27, to allow preparations for the election of a new speaker. Until that time, the deputy speakers will chair the House proceedings. Thank you. Merci. I hope I pronounced that correctly. Merci. I'm not French. Cautionary tale. I'm assuming the guy didn't realize, you know, if we want to give him some benefit of the doubt. But, yeah, listen, you know, if you're going to have somebody come and speak to Parliament, check their background. Make sure they're not a Nazi. You know, I mean, that seems like common sense. But as George Carlin used to say, some people need practical advice. And I would say that applies to anything, you know, that you're doing. If you're having someone come and speak to Parliament, if you're having someone come and give some sort of a presentation of any kind, if you're, you know, if someone's going to be a guest on your radio show, whatever it is, look into their background. Make sure they're not a Nazi, you know, because if they are, that's someone you probably don't want anything to do with. So I'm just saying. Just throwing that out there. All right. I think he did the right thing by resigning. I mean, that is embarrassing. And what Trudeau said was absolutely correct. That is a tremendous embarrassment. I'm assuming he didn't know. And if he did know, that's really bad. Because what does that say about him if he did know? All right. We have to, we got to get to break. I'm going to play. Now, this is a song. This was requested that the band asked me to play this, one of their great studio tracks. This is called Bandit, and the song is Fox and the Flamingos, and they are coming up next. They're going to perform for us live in studio, but this is a really great track. Check this out. We're going to play this, and we're going to show some love to our amazing sponsors, and then we'll be back with hour number two, Numero Dos, Matt Connerton Unleashed. Fox and the Flamingos will be live in studio.
I don't know what you think, but I know what I know. is a song I want to tell from way back, deep like a well. There is a song I need to say. It seems it somehow got away. I'm just killing time until time kills me. A coin for the ferryman, a ring for the sea. Give light to darkness, give life unto clay. Till time kills me, I'm killing time today. There is a story from the distant past, before the first came the last. There is a story I need to share. Came from no place and it's going nowhere. I'm just killing time until time kills me. A coin for the ferryman, a ring for the sea. Give light to darkness, give life unto clay. Until time kills me, I'm killing time today. A message that must be conveyed from whatever place you have made. There was a message I needed to pass on, but it's gone, it's gone, it's gone, 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 gone. I'm just killing time until time kills me. Coin for the ferryman, a ring for the sea. Give light to darkness, give life unto clay. Until time kills me, I'm killing time today. I'm just killing time until time kills me. A coin for the ferryman, a ring for. Give light to darkness, give life unto clay. Till time kills me, I'm killing time today. I'm killing time today.
Welcome back, everybody. It is Matt Connerton, Unleashed, and we are well into hour number two at Numero Dos here from the studios of WMNH 95.3 FM in glorious downtown Manchester, New Hampshire. Also on Comcast 97 if you're, oh, I did it again, Comcast Channel 6 if you're in Manchester. And of course, hello to all of our online listeners across the nation and around the globe. You can go to my website, mattconnerton.com, for all of your live streaming options, social media links, contact info, show archives, et cetera, et cetera. Today is Tuesday, September 26, 2023. And let me bring up these mics here. We've got some musicians here in studio with us. This great band, Fox and the Flamingos. And let's see, that's Gary over there on the couch, which is where I think you were the last time you were here, wasn't it?
Yeah, pretty close to this. Yeah, me and Mark were squeezed on the seat.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Me and my
nice. Nice. Yeah.
Very cool. What we should do, Gary, why don't you, because not everyone has a mic, why don't you introduce everybody? If you would, everyone who's in the band.
Sure, yeah. Lead singer over here is Maisie Ray. She's a wonderful singer. She's the sprite and the young energy of the band because we're a bunch of old guys.
Yeah.
Hi, Maisie. Welcome.
Tyler on guitar, Tyler Moran. He's been playing guitar forever. Very, very creative. He does very good, all of our digital art, ultimately, which... is something I could never do, so we're thankful for that. You met Ryan Pratt, our drummer, down there on his pared down kit.
Yes, yes.
Me and him have been playing together for a long time. Actually, me and Ryan Bossy, too, our piano player, we've been playing off and on for a long time. Bossy's in a bunch of different bands. He gets all over the place, too. So, that's it. And I'm Gary Smith. I'm playing this and that other band, Jam Tomorrow, that was here. And it's a fun project for sure.
Yeah, we played Bandit earlier. Yeah. And really good song, really good song. And I know we have some other studio tracks too, but I'm dying to hear you all live. Can I just have each of you just play something quick so I can kind of we got to do this on the fly, a little sound check here.
For sure.
But okay. Okay, and I'll adjust the levels as we go, obviously, but sounds good. Okay, awesome. And Maisie?
Test one, two.
All right, sounds great. Like I said, I'll ride the faders as we go to adjust. I'm pretty, you know, we're sort of limited as terms of what we can do here, obviously, but I'm pretty good at that. So I'm sure it'll sound good. I'm dying to hear you all play. So whenever you're ready.
Yeah.
Yeah.
gotta do right by me. First she gets to saying goodbye. She gotta think twice, she gotta do right by me.
Very nice. Very nice. If you're just joining us, we have Fox and the Flamingos live in studio with us. And
just breaking equipment.
All right. As long as it's your own, that's cool with me.
It is.
It's very rock star, actually.
We'll just pretend he smashed
that particular one. I decided to give in. You have a dumpster downstairs.
Well, yeah, actually. In the alley, there is one. By the way, so Dylan Reynolds, very talented musician in the chat room, he says, I'm getting a rockabilly bluesy vibe from this. Very awesome.
Thank you. That's really cool. Comment.
Thanks for the compliment.
And we have a call. I think this is our friend Charles Richardson, probably has a question for y'all. Charles, is that you?
Yeah. I don't have a question. I just have a lot of praise. Holy bleepity bleep. That was amazing.
Thank you.
That honestly didn't sound, that sounded clearer than a CD. That is amazing.
You guys jammed
it, rocked it out. I love that song. Now I love it even more. Big thanks to that. First off, who is that young lady on vocals?
Oh, that's Maisie Ray.
She's got a set of pipes on her, let me tell you. Dang. Yes. I'm just saying, listen, I just had to call in and give my praise because standing on Facebook chat wouldn't give it any justice. You guys flipping rock.
Thank you so much.
That's awesome. Thank you.
Thank you for the call, Charles. Very good.
I'm all teary-eyed. That's so sweet.
Yeah, that's nice. That's very nice. How long has this band been together? How long have y'all?
We'll be 2 years in November.
Okay.
So we're a year and change.
Okay.
We're all experienced musicians that have kind of come from different areas and different genre, different upbringings, different influences and genres, etc. And that definitely adds to our sound, if you will. But putting the band together itself was pretty no brainer when we were putting the pieces together, and the sound has just kind of evolved and it continues to grow.
For sure.
And is it always the same configuration when you play out? Because it seems like you'd have some flexibility with a project like this if somebody can't be there or something. Does that ever change?
We are very much like a unit. We don't like to do things without one or the other. We've never done a show without the five of us as a unit, like I said. We do want eventually to add in some horns. We've talked about a saxophone, backup singers, down the road eventually.
Yeah,
we're, Maisie plays keys and, we can all start to experiment in different in areas like that with, we're starting the discussions of, what if Maisie played keys on this song and, I sing backup vocals, but like Gary mentioned before, I play in another band and I sing, lead and sing things like that too. So, we do some sort of duet kind of songs where we both kind of take the lead in the middle of it too. So we definitely have some flexibility there.
Yeah. Your voices sound great together.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. That really stood out on that track, on that song. Let's play. So Gary, you'd also sent me, it's called Without Love.
Yeah.
Studio track?
Yeah.
We'll give this a listen. Anything we should know about this before we play it?
This all three of our songs that you'll be hearing tonight, they're all kind of songs that we kind of collectively wrote, started from a riff and kind of just blossomed at a practice to go from there. And that's kind of how they've all been written. This song is very unique from the other two, as a lot of our songs kind of. This is a different vibe than Bandit for sure, but Bandit's a little more up-tempo. This is more a little laid back. Bossy has a cool little like rappy reggae part that's in there that's really really unique. We tend to like let our songs go for longer than the normal pop length, so I don't think we've ever made like a 3-minute song.
All right, very cool. Let's give this a listen. So this is called Without Love. This is studio track by Fox and the Flamingos, and then we'll come back and they're gonna play for us some more.
And your drug perpetuate your soul to love and find that you ever woke. Believe the love is all around everything. Let it move you, let it choose it, so your soul can just sing. Realize with your eyes that the skies are the prize. If you're wise, you'll derive all the reasons inside.
Tell me what on earth would you do without love?
I have not a single
thank you.
That's nice. Without Love, that is Fox and the Flamingos, and they are here with us live in studio. Great track. Great track.
Thank you.
And Maisie, you've got a great voice. How did you, are you, did you have formal training or are you self-taught? Or?
If you'd asked my mom, she'd tell you that I came out the womb singing.
Yeah.
She told me I used to sing myself to sleep when I was like 3 years old.
Yeah.
And I did take voice workshop. It's a class in high school. All throughout my high school, shout out to Mrs. Erdody. She was an amazing teacher and definitely like gave me a lot of technique to work with, taught me all about the importance of warming up and taking care of your voice and stage presence, which, you know, it's sometimes it's funny how you learn things in high school, but then you have to relearn them again after you graduate.
Right.
So, yeah. That's all though.
Yeah.
My father is a musician and so is my uncle. My uncle Andrew was in a band called C Note.
Okay.
Back in the 90s, a boy band.
Oh, and no kidding.
Lou Pearlman was their manager.
No kidding.
Yeah, he's an amazing singer. Andrew Rogers. He went by Drew Rogers. So, you know, I guess I get a lot of my natural ability from my dad's side of the family.
Oh, wow. I'd like to get him on the show.
I could probably make that happen.
Seriously, I'd have a
he does live in Florida, so it'd have to be like a Zoom,
you can call in or Skype in. Yeah, no problem. No, that sounds interesting. It always helps if you come, I think, from a musical family, you know, and have that upbringing. Let's see. Dan Morin joins us in the Facebook live chat, and I thought that might be
my dad.
That's a new name. So, very nice. Speaking of supportive families, there you go.
Yeah, he's also a musician.
Great. Okay.
He's amazing.
Great bass player.
Excellent. Excellent. And also Patrick Couturier?
Yeah.
Hey, Pat.
How do you say it? I was way off.
Hey, Pat.
I've always said Couturier, but
Couturier.
I've never asked him. It was just Pat.
Pat says, I'm really digging this track, guys. Pretty tight with the great groove. Rock on.
Thanks, bud.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Tony Petrello, I don't know if you know Tony, he's also a musician. He says they are really good, and he wrote really good in all caps.
Love it.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for the love, y'all.
Absolutely. And Dan Morin says, hi, guys. Jenny says, this is awesome. Jay Fed from Vermont says, I'm digging this. Yeah, so you're getting a lot of love in there. Absolutely.
All right. I'm smiling so big right now. <can't see>
We'd love to play in Vermont.
Yes.
Tell some places about us.
We will.
Yeah. Where do you play? Do you play a lot of shows?
Yeah, so here in Manchester, we've played at Murphy's Tap Room. We've also played at the Shaskeen. That was a really good time too. We play all over New England.
We played at Angel City Music
Hall. New England, New Hampshire. Yeah. We have a show coming up in Worcester, and that'll be our first out of state show.
Mm-hmm.
So
excellent.
That's exciting.
And we're doing Pumpkin Fest in Milford in a couple weekends. So
doing the headlining stage next weekend, and then we play that night at the Pasta Loft Event Center.
Yeah, right across the street.
Double show back to back Saturday night at the Pumpkin Festival in Milford this year. Yeah.
Excellent, excellent. JFed says you can play at his house if you want to play in Vermont.
All right,
but he might try to talk you into getting into an ice bath. I don't remember if that came up, Gary, when you were here. The ice bath, yeah.
I just did my first sauna this past week.
Oh no, kidding, yeah,
nice.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you. Yes, it is the opposite. Good point.
Hot is the opposite of cold.
That is
if
true.
If anyone was wondering,
that is true.
It's like this.
JFed also, he's wondering, and of course this doesn't apply to all of you, obviously, but he likes to ask everybody, have you ever considered increasing the length of your beards?
I'm the only one that has. Mine was pretty good for a while.
Gary's was down almost like to the middle of his chest.
Really? Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, I can't. I get told my neck gets itchy and things like that, so I got
mine
keep
could
it pretty
be
much
like
regular.
A little longer.
Yeah, you could work on that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mine I just trimmed today. So my dad's is down to his belly button.
Is it really? Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, wow. He does have a long.
Yeah, he's good. I think he met like terminal length already. But.
It's always funny seeing pictures of your dad because I can tell how old he is by how long his beard is.
Yes.
Because he's just gotten older, longer and longer as he's gotten older.
Yeah.
Like the rings in a tree.
Yeah.
I saw one the other day and it was like as short as mine. And I was like, whoa, he was really ugly.
Well, would you like to play another song? I'd love to hear another one.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, if you couldn't tell, we'd like to take our own little spin on popular covers. So this is another one of those.
Excellent.
smile. Tell me, why are you still so afraid? Mm-hmm. Where's the fire with the hurry about? You better cool it off before you burn it out. You got so much to do and only so many hours in a day. Can't be everything you wanna be before your time. Although it's so romantic on the borderline tonight, tonight. Too bad, but it's the life you lead. You're so ahead of yourself that you forgot what you need. Though you can see when you're wrong, you know you can't always see when you're right. Right. You got your passion, you got your pride, but don't you know that only fools are satisfied. That you can give what you want, now you can just get old. You're gonna kick off before you even get halfway through. Ooh, ooh, ooh. And will you realize being away for you? Kick off before you even get halfway through.
Awesome. Awesome. Great job.
Thank you.
Fox and the Flamingos is here live in studio with us. Jack Polner in the Facebook live chat says, these guys are awesome, and my wife and I buy cars from the bassist.
Thanks, Jack.
You had to have known that was coming. Right?
Somebody out there.
Yeah.
And let's see. Carol Zaworowitz says, great music. Wonder Suede says, this is so cool. We say from us, we say that you can come to Greensboro, North Carolina sometime. Fox and the Flamingos. Maybe you can do a version song of Ticket to Ride.
Love it.
That's how they awesome. That's how they talk in Greensboro.
We would need a ticket to ride as well.
Right. Yes. Hello to Miriam Banish in the chat room. Where does the name come from, by the way?
It's funny. So, you know, when we put the group together, it had started actually between Ryan Pratt and Gary and myself. We were actually jamming up at Ryan's uncle's house in the basement. You know, he had a full drum kit and the whole setup and whatnot. And we were talking. We were like, I'd love to put together a funk band with a female lead singer. And then somewhere along the line, I just got this notion of wanting to be like Huey Lewis and the News, you know, like a blank, you know, a front person. And then the backing band is you know, a fun name, right?
And Huey Lewis and the News was already taken.
And Huey Lewis,
unfortunately
it was top on our list. But, you know, my backup was Hootie and the Blowfish. But I got the notion of wanting to be the Flamingos. I just loved that, like, notion of, you know, there's so much flavor, if you will, in all things flamingo and what people, you know, what you think about when you think flamingo, you think fun and party and, you know, warm weather, lively atmosphere, et cetera, and all the possible combinations. And then we started the group and Maisie joined and we were, you know, really, we're like, okay, we're a band. And there was one night, it must have been 10:30 at night. I'm sitting on the couch watching TV and Maze and I are chatting and I just happened to ask her, I was like, hey Maze, what's your spirit animal? And I mean, it's one of those things where you see the three bubbles pop up as soon as you send it through. There was no thinking. Yeah. And she was like, Fox. And I was like, boom.
Oh, wow.
Fox and the Flamingos just runs right off. And we had a whole list of names that we were chatting about. And, you know, Blank and the Flamingos, they knew that, you know, that was going to be out there. And I was like, guys, this has got to happen. So,
Like, you threw that out there. In the group chat, you threw that out there. And then for weeks, we kept throwing out names and trying to come up with something quote unquote better.
I was pushing for that one. Well, I really was pushing for that one. And I think that's why we initially ended on that one.
For sure.
You know.
And like, as soon as he threw that out there, because I was designing stuff, I started designing logos right away with that name before we decided on it. So I was like, that's the name. There's not going to be, there's no other name for it, especially with her, like with the Fox thing. Like, we just knew right away. Like,
No doubt. Very cool.
I did used to be a redhead, blonde now, of course, but it was
it was fitting.
I had my little moment of rebellion.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm an Arctic Fox now.
There you go. We have a call. Our friend Mike Doyle is on the line. Hi, Mike.
Hi, Mike.
Hey, Matt. How's everything going?
Good. How are you?
Very good. Very good. You got a full studio there. Hey, I just want to tell you, I am a connoisseur. Nothing against the band. They play great.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm a connoisseur of female voices, and I'm putting this young lady in my top 10.
There you go.
You just made my day.
She's phenomenal.
Thank you so much.
And the tones and sliding in and out of different octaves or whatever you would call it is just phenomenal. And the band backing her up is well, I'll give them a step behind, but they're really good.
We'll take it.
Yep.
We'll take it.
Yeah, great job. Great. I already looked up trying to buy an album and looking up all your stuff and what's out there I can find for you. And I already put you on my Shazam.
That is unreal.
And,
Thank you.
Yeah.
There'll be more.
Just because I really want to, believe me, don't get me wrong. The band is great, but she's phenomenal.
Oh, very nice.
That's all I wanted to say.
Very nice.
Thanks for the love, brother. All
right, Mike, thank you for the call. Appreciate it.
Talk to you later.
All right, bye-bye.
See you.
All right, very nice. Well, that's cool.
I'm speechless.
Yeah.
These guys definitely helped build me into the musician I am, though. I mean, I've had the voice, but it's taken a lot to get to where I am with stage presence and just confidence in general on stage, and it's still building in me, and I'm still figuring out how to get to that sweet spot without drinking too much. Or
we told her a million times. So she's got the natural talent, and luckily we can bring it out of her. I'm glad everybody else is seeing that too.
Yeah.
This reassures us.
Yeah, absolutely. Stephanie Marie in the Facebook live chat says, "Hi, Fox and the Flamingos. You guys sound great tonight."
Thank you, Steph.
Thank you, Stephanie Marie.
Very nice. Did you want to do one more live one? I don't know how many were you guys planning on doing.
We have another one if you want us to.
Somebody in the chat room requested Superstitious. That you guys do a great version of that. But whatever you want to play. Yeah.
That would probably be a little tough.
This is the first time touching my acoustic since this band started.
The biggest thing would be for Pratt, our drummer, because he's on a Cajoni right now. Cajoni?
Cajoni. I gotcha.
Ryan's no stranger to the Cajon. He and I used to do a little acoustic duo group called Little Kings, and it was and he has this whole what he calls the Franken kit, where he builds it around the Cajon. He's got all these djembes and timbales and chimes and whatnot. So he's no stranger. But
By the way, I want to get this in. Stephanie Marie also said these guys have worked so hard to really hone in their skills, and watching them grow, not only as individuals, but as a whole group, has been amazing. So very nice.
Thank you, Steph.
Thanks, Steph.
Very nice. Yeah.
Thanks, Band Mom.
Band Mommy.
Very cool. But play whatever you want. We
did prepare another one. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yep.
This will be in.
Thank you guys. You got it.
This is, if you're just joining us, this is Fox and the Flamingos live in studio.
Heaven brings our
God. That was so good.
Thank you.
Wow.
Thank you.
Wow. Fox and the Flamingos, ladies and gentlemen, live in studio with us. That was great. Listen, before we run out of time, so obviously we have one more song to play this new. So this will be the first time this has been heard, Gary, when we...
Yeah, besides us sending it around to our friends, really, it hasn't made it onto any of the streaming things. We're going to do something a little more special for this than we did for the first two, where we kind of just spat them out on all the platforms. We're going to probably do something a little more special for this, so stay tuned for that, but...
So this will be a world premiere.
World premiere. Yeah, just like this and all the Jam Tomorrow songs we recorded. Yeah. Boards House Productions and Brookline. Pete is a great producer.
Yes, shout out Pete Pelequin.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Very nice, very nice. And also, what should people know about where to find Fox and the Flamingos online? Shows?
We are on Facebook. We're on Instagram. We're constantly posting new show dates. We have a post on our Facebook. It shows all of our upcoming dates. We're on Spotify, Apple Music, iTunes.
Yep.
Anywhere you can get music.
Yeah, and our YouTube channel is pretty vast. Yeah, we
post all our live shows.
Yep, we do recordings of all of our live shows and post them there. So if you miss it, you have a chance to see it.
Excellent. Very happy to have you all here. This has been amazing. And like I said, too, you got a lot of love in the Facebook live chat. Everybody's digging what you're doing.
Thanks again, everybody. Yeah, we appreciate that so much.
Absolutely. Dan Morin says, nicely done. I'm proud of you guys.
We love you,
Thanks,
Dan.
Thanks, Bob.
Very nice. All right. So we will wrap up with this. And by the way, if you missed any part of today's show, it will be up in just a little bit at WMNHradio.org and at my website, mattconnerton.com. And this is the premiere. This is the world premiere of the brand new track from Fox and the Flamingos. This is called Don't Be a Stranger. And again, thanks, everybody. This has been amazing.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks again, Matt.
Absolutely.
Been awesome.